Good morning. And a warm welcome to our service this morning at Cockpen in Carrington. And also a very warm welcome to all those who will be watching the recording. In our theme today, we will look at part of the continuing Easter story, with Jesus' appearance first to his disciples when they are still hidden away, and then later his return visit when Thomas was also present. We'll think about the peace and reassurance Jesus brings them, and indeed brings us in our lives today. And I know that Liz has some intimations for us.
Can I just ask you all to please note that our ASM, which was scheduled to take place here in church after service on Sunday, the 21st of April, has now been postponed. We're not quite ready for it, and a time and a date, a new date, will be arranged, and I will let you all know when that is. So we're kind of light on the ground today, so if you can kind of spread the word around to other people that this is in fact happening. And their tea and toast morning held in the hall yesterday. Numbers were down a bit, but even at that, we raised £482.65, which I think was quite a good sum. So can I say thanks to everyone who helped in any way at all. Those that came along and supported us for the event and the raffle, etc., and the tombola, and all those that gave us prizes for it, for the home bacon, for flowers, just for everything, and all those that contributed from in the kitchen to running around serving. And I say a big thank you, because without you, we couldn't do it. And can I just say that the raffle of the blanket, which some of the ladies in the Natter did, we raffled that, and Catherine Devlin won it. So that's where that went. And just before I sit down, we have another significant birthday. There's no zero in the end of it this time, but I just feel it is, it's a wee bit more than 70. So yesterday, Betty Cousins here was 91. So, you like to come up?
So yeah, that's from all your friends at Cockpen, Carrington, and Betty. I hope you had a lovely day in your family. You had a lovely day in this park as well. Okay. Take care.
Let us be still as we come to worship. In our call to worship this morning, there is a response. After I say Christ is risen, I invite you to join in. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. However we come, in excitement or tears, in calm or fear, you meet us all and bring us joy. Lift our spirits, risen Saviour. Reassure us by your presence. Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Hallelujah. Let us join to sing in our opening hymn of praise this morning, 424, Blessed be the everlasting God. Let us join in our opening prayer. Let us pray. Loving God, as we continue in this Easter season, we come again to give you thanks and praise for the joy and hope we know through Jesus, our risen Lord and Saviour. Thank you for your enduring pain, for your gracious love that determined to make us one with you again. Through Jesus' willing sacrifice and through his resurrection to new life. Lord Jesus, we give you thanks for your living presence here among us through your Holy Spirit. We thank you that you are with us always as our friend and guide, as our comfort and encourager. Glory to you, gracious and merciful Lord. We come before you with humble hearts in the stillness of this sacred place. We confess our shortcomings and seek your forgiveness. We acknowledge the doubts that linger within us and the moments when our faith wavers. Like the disciples in the locked room, we sometimes find ourselves paralyzed by fear. Fear of the unknown, fear of inadequacy, and fear of the challenges that lie ahead. In those moments, we have doubted your presence and questioned your plans for us. In the spirit of Thomas, we confess that there are times when we demand tangible evidence, seeking assurance in what we can see and touch, rather than trusting in the unseen reality of your love and grace. Lord, forgive us for the times we have struggled to fully trust in your resurrection power. Forgive us for the moments when we've allowed doubt to overshadow the profound truth of your victory over death. May the same spirit that breathed peace into the locked room breathe forgiveness and renewal into our hearts today. Empower us to go forth with courage, sharing the good news of your resurrection and embodying the love that casts out fear. We thank you for this time of worship and fellowship together now. By your Spirit, may we be one in heart and mind, rejoicing in your presence and being spiritually renewed in communion with you. And we join now in the words you taught us to pray. Let us join to sing our next hymn, hymn 412, The Strife Is O'er, The Battle Done.
Today's reading is from the Gospel of St. John. I'm reading from the Good News Bible, and it's chapter 20, verses 19 to 31. Jesus appears to his disciples. It was late that Sunday evening, and the disciples were gathered together behind locked doors because they were afraid of the Jewish authorities. Then Jesus came and stood among them. "Peace be with you," he said. After saying this, he showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy at seeing the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I send you." Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." One of the 12 disciples, Thomas, called the twin, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." Thomas said unto them, "Unless I see the scars of the nails in his hands, and put my finger on those scars, and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, the disciples were together again indoors, and Thomas was with them. The doors were locked, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and look at my hands. Then stretch out your hand and put it in my side. Stop your doubting and believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Do you believe because you see me? How happy are those who believe without seeing me?" So, the purpose of this book, in his disciples' presence, Jesus performed many other miracles which were not written down in this book. But these have been written in order that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through your faith in him, you may have life. Amen, and may God bless the reading of this word.
Thank you, Helen. And now let us join to sing again our next hymn 432, "How Often We Like Thomas Need Proof Before We Trust."
Thank you.
We come to very familiar words in our passage today from John, because we remember, celebrate, and share them each time we have communion together. Jesus came and stood in the middle of his disciples and said, "Peace be with you." It's interesting to notice the setting that Jesus comes into. It's the evening now of that first Easter day. Even though they have heard from Mary that very morning that she has seen the risen Jesus, the disciples are hidden away behind locked doors for fear of the religious authorities. As yet, they do not live bold, joyous, and confident lives, empowered by the news that Jesus is alive again. But Jesus comes to this fearful group of disciples, giving them his peace, sending them out to continue his ministry, and empowering them with the gift of the Holy Spirit. We learn that Thomas was not there on Jesus' first visit, and so the disciples announce to Thomas that they have seen the Lord, but he doesn't believe them. He will need to see and touch the marks of the nails in Jesus' hand and the wounds in his side before he will believe Jesus is alive. The heart of our passage today is that Jesus comes again and again to those scared and confused disciples. As Gail O'Day says in Feasting on the Word, the disciples have not warranted a second visit by Jesus, but they get one, and a renewed gift of his peace. Thomas is given exactly what he has requested, a chance to see and touch Jesus for himself. We see Jesus' graciousness to offer himself and the repeated gift of his presence and his peace to his fearful and uncertain disciples. There is much wrapped up in the few simple words, "Peace be with you." As Bruce Milne writes in his commentary, Jesus would have offered his disciples the greeting, "Shalom, peace be with you." Shalom, that familiar Hebrew greeting, means so much more than the mere absence of stress, which is what we tend to understand of peace today. In its Old Testament context, shalom basically means well-being in its fullest sense. It gathers up all the blessings of the kingdom of God. Shalom is life at its best under the gracious hand of God. As William Barclay puts it, Jesus' greeting means, "May God give you every good thing." And Bruce Milne goes on to point out that this greeting, shalom, peace be with you from Jesus, is at its most apt that first Easter evening, precisely because Jesus has brought the kingdom of God into realization by his death and rising. Now and only now is shalom a realizable blessing. The peace of reconciliation and life from God is now imparted. As we hear Jesus' words to his disciples, shalom, peace be with you, to calm and encourage his disciples in their setting, so we can open to hear them in our setting too. Jesus comes again and again to the scared, anxious, confused disciples, and he is always with us in our fears, anxieties, and uncertainties. As Gail O'Day again shares on Easter Sunday morning, we may hold at bay all of our worries, concerns, and doubts amidst the wonder and celebration of Jesus' rising again. But it doesn't take long for cares and worries to creep back in again. The Easter Gospel turns the world upside down, but we live out our days in the right side up experiences of our ongoing lives. As Jesus understands the ongoing fear and doubt of his disciples, he came to them repeatedly and gave them his peace in its deepest sense. And because Jesus is alive and with us always, when we stop and open our hearts and lives to him, we can receive that same richest blessing of his peace in our fears and doubts through all that life brings. In our passage, Jesus comes out only to reassure his disciples. He comes also to prepare them for what lies ahead. In being sent out to continue Jesus' mission to take God's truth and love into the world. As he says to them, "As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." These are fearful disciples, and that's a daunting task, but Jesus gives them the gift of the Holy Spirit. After he commissions his disciples, we read, "With that he breathed on them and said, 'Receive the Holy Spirit.'" William Barclay offers some wonderful insights into what is taking place here. There is no doubt that when John spoke in this way, he was thinking back to the old story of the creation of man. There, the writer says, "And the Lord God formed man of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." This was the same picture as Ezekiel saw when he saw the valley of dead, dry bones, and when he heard God say to the wind, "Come from the four winds, O breath, and breathe upon those slain, that they may live." The coming of the Holy Spirit is like a new creation. It is like the awakening of life from the dead. For the disciples, it is a life-giving empowerment to step outside their fears and become Jesus' witness in the world. And always and everywhere, when the Holy Spirit comes upon the church, she is reawakened and recreated for her task. As we learn in our passage today, and as Gail O'Day concludes, Easter is real, not simply in the joyous celebrations of Easter Day, but as it unfolds in the lives and stories of disciples who are regularly tempted to fear and despair. John 20, 19 to 31, paints a vivid picture of the disciples, of their needs and wants, while at the same time portraying the risen Jesus in all the abundance of his grace. In all the joys and struggles of our lives, Jesus goes with us too, in all the service of our lives to share Jesus' love in our community and our world. The life-giving power of the Holy Spirit goes with us and before us. Easter is real, and its impact flows on as we recognize and welcome Jesus in our very midst, wherever we are and wherever we go. Amen. Let us join to sing Jesus is risen from the grave. Our worship in our offering.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Lord, we also commit to you now these gifts of money offered here and in other ways today. These are tokens of our love for you, and we pray that they may be used to share your love and hope in our world, to your glory and praise. Amen. And we join now in our prayers of thanksgiving and for others and ourselves. Let us pray. Loving God, in this season of Easter, may we make time to rejoice in our risen Lord, for no tomb could hold you, no heart is barred to you, no mind shut off from you. We give thanks for your grace descending upon us, bringing renewal, strength, and the assurance of your presence. We give thanks that you lead us out of darkness into light, from doubt into faith, out of death into eternal, life eternal. Thank you, Lord, for the precious gift of unity, a gift that reflects the essence of your nature. We give grateful thanks for the fellowship we share as brothers and sisters in Christ, bound together by the love that surpasses all understanding. God of peace, we pray for those who live in areas of conflict, in Gaza, where aid workers have been injured and killed, in Ukraine, where residents face Russian raids, in Lebanon, where United Nations observers have been injured. May your love embrace those in pain, and may your wisdom be granted to decision makers and those in authority. God of compassion, we pray for all in our community and beyond, facing unemployment or worries about money, continuing to struggle to make ends meet. We seek your blessing on all who volunteer at food banks and at the local food pantry, for all who continue to donate groceries, and we pray for supportive relationships, practical provision, and real hope. We pray for all those in pain, for all in hospital, at home, or in care homes, for all awaiting tests, results, or undergoing treatment, and for all who are anxious for themselves or loved ones. We pray for those who feel isolated and alone, for all suffering with mental health issues. May they know places of welcome and safety. We remember and pray for all who grieve the loss of loved ones. Fill them with your peace, that they may find their strength and hope in you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we now join to sing our final hymn this morning, hymn 427, Alleluia, Alleluia, hearts to heaven and voices raised.
Thank you.
have been in the presence of God and our Lord Jesus Christ, and have been renewed and restored, may we go now in the love and peace of the Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be with us all now and evermore.